Sacrifice of praise into the house. trying to figure out who I am. And I'm just going to read a little bit, and we'll see how many long-time CMA people we have here. I was born in Madras, India, on March 26, 1946. Growing up, I was familiar with Christianity, but very skeptical of the Anglican view I was exposed to. Overcome with shame and anguish, and being a poor student, I attempted suicide at the age of 17. While in the hospital, a local Christian worker gave me a Bible. After reading through the book of John, I committed my life to Christ, praying that, Jesus, if you are the one who gives life as it is meant to be, I want it. Please get me out of this hospital dead well, and I promise I will leave no stone unturned in my pursuit of truth. Show of hands, anybody who thinks they got it? Oh, you guys are good. Anybody want to volunteer?
Robbie Zacharias.
Yes. Robbie graduated Ontario Bible College in 1972, began ministry with the Christian Missionary Alliance in Canada. He was ordained by CMA in 1980 and even taught a few years at the Alliance Theological Seminary. He continued to spend the next 40 years as a brilliant apologetic, defending his faith and teaching others to do the same. He's the author of over 30 books and founded Robbie Zacharias International Ministries. Robbie recently passed away on May 19th of this year of a rare cancer in his spine. For the past few years, I've been fascinated with honor and what it means to live a life of honor. Robbie Zacharias is an example of a man who lived his life with honor, boldly defending his faith and his God. At his funeral, he was honored by many, including Tim Tebow and our Vice President, Mike Pence. So, for the next couple of weeks, I will share a few specific ways that Robbie showed honor in his life as it affected my life. I want to read a passage of scripture from Romans. When I looked up honor and I searched, and it's actually very enlightening. There was lots of uses of the word honor in the Old and New Testament. In the Old Testament, you have someone or a king or someone who was buried with honor. And then you have a king that was buried without honor. The more I looked through both the Old Testament and the New Testament, I realized that honor is spoken very, very often, very frequently throughout Scripture. But this is a verse that I hadn't come across before, and I thought was very interesting. Romans chapter 12, verse 9. Let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. You know, Paul was a great writer, and he knew how to write. He knew how to articulate. He would be, I think, probably along the same brainwave as Robbie Zacharias. They could probably communicate very well, with one another. And so, I don't know that it's, he could have said, be honored, show honor, be an honorable person. But this idea of outdo one another in showing honor, I don't know. Think about that. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for your word. Thank you for how full it is of wisdom and instruction for our current daily life. Just pray for each one of us that we would do what Paul has asked us to do, that we would show honor amongst ourselves and the people that we come in contact with. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Please stand with us. We sing in the splendor and the full. us. And for those of you who support this ministry in your prayers and financially, we are so grateful to you. We thank you so much. And we encourage you just to go to our site at fbcma.org. And you'll see the donate button right there. Really often that way. Let's go before the Lord. Heavenly Father, you have given us everything as we have just sung. You have emptied yourself, taking on the form of a human being such as us. And you live among us. You know what it's like to be human. You know what it's like to be tempted and yet without sin. You know what it's like to suffer. You know what it's like to die. You know what it's like to rise again from the dead and to be seated at the right hand of the Father, fully glorified, restored completely in your eternal relationship with your Father. That's what you have promised to us if we trust in you. And so, Lord Jesus, we are here to worship you. We're here to worship our Heavenly Father, made known to us so beautifully and perfectly in Jesus. In our worship, Lord, we want to give because you've given to us. It's just in the nature of love to do that. So we give you our offerings. We give you our tithes. We give you our very lives as a thank you and a praise offering in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
go into prayer this morning, I'll just ask you, as the church family, some of you saw this via email, please keep our sister Betty in your prayers. Her son, Rod, is now in hospice care, and she's looking at the loss of her second son, her second child. This is a very tough time for them, so please keep her and her son Rod and his wife and their entire family in prayers. I also want to mention that this is in your bulletin, and I'm not going to read it for you, but on the bottom of the inside page, you'll see a note there about Toby and Kirsten Hall. Many of you know the Halls. They've been here at Friendship more than once, and missionaries, CNA missionaries out in West Africa. I'll just abbreviate it this way. It's been tough with COVID and all of that. It's been tough being a missionary. They are under threat not only of COVID, but also of ISIS. And they just recently completed a training with a bunch of new disciples. And they are on fire to share the gospel under very difficult circumstances. So keep them in prayer and pray that God will give them boldness in the face of adversity, that he will give them victory and success for the kingdom. Let's go ahead. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. We know you because of Jesus. And we thank you, Lord God, that in Christ we have victory. In Christ we have life. And we thank you, Lord God, that you have laid out before not only us, your church, but you have laid out before all mankind what a perfect human being looks like. What you designed the human race to be like. And that in Jesus, you are establishing a new humanity. A humanity that is given a new life in Christ. To be shaped like him and one day to be glorified like him and perfected like him. Never again. To be wrestling with the sin and horror that sin brings into our lives. We thank you, Lord God, for loving us so much. And we thank you for the victory that is ours in Jesus Christ. And we do pray for our sister Betty. We pray as she comes before you and casts her tears at your feet on behalf of her son. Our hearts break with hers, and we weep with her. We pray for her son, and we pray for her and her family. Be merciful to them. Reach down deep to that family where we can't go. Bring life and healing and hope and promise. We pray, Lord, for the Halls and for others like them who are serving your kingdom in very, very difficult places, and sometimes under the threat of terror, sometimes under the threat of COVID-19 and other things, and sometimes some of them in war zones, and some just in very, very hard, calloused, spiritually cold places. We pray for those who are serving you, separate from their homeland, often separate from their family, their friends, and their churches, and out there on the front lines, reaching people for Jesus, give them boldness, give them the freshness of their walk with you, so that as they share Jesus, it would not just be a story, it would not just be a sermon, it would be their life that they are pouring out, the life with Christ. Father, we pray this morning for our church plant in Gainesville. We are thrilled, Lord, that you have raised up Brother Randy to have that work. We are thrilled, Lord, that you have brought alongside him those who are making up a core group, and that you have opened up doors in Gainesville and opened up hearts in Gainesville. And today, Lord, as they open their time of worship this afternoon, we pray, Lord, that the gospel seed that has been planted across Gainesville in conversation, in flyers, and radio ads and so many other ways, we pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would draw just those people that you have appointed to be there this afternoon, to sit on the gospel, and that, Lord, there would be fruit for the kingdom, people saved out of darkness and brought into your marvelous light. We thank you, Lord, for those from this church who in one way or another has stepped up to support this great work. And we pray, Lord, that your blessing would rest upon their sacrifice of time, their sacrifice sometimes of expense, finances, and whatever other sacrifices, even sometimes some of the away from family. That, Lord, you would bless that, and that they would see fruit for the kingdom of God that would last in eternity. And that they would know that they don't do it for anybody but you, for anybody's praise but yours. On that day, we will see you face to face and say, well done. Lord, we pray for our time as a gathering here, for those who are worshiping with us online, that you would meet us right where we are. We thank you, Lord, that walls and miles and geography are no barrier to you. You're present immediately with each one. And so we pray, Lord, for the outpouring of your word. And that your spirit would drive your word into human hearts and would be changed. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you turn with me in your Bibles to 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verses 1 through 13. So when we could stand it no longer, we thought we'd be left by ourselves in Athens. And we sent Timothy, who was our brother and co-worker in God's service in spreading the gospel of Christ, to strengthen and encourage you in your faith, so that no one would be unsettled by these trials. For you know quite well that we are destined for them. In fact, when we were with you, we kept telling you that we would be persecuted, and it turned out that way, as you all know. For the reason, when I could stand it no longer, I sent to find out about your faith. I was afraid that in some way the tempter had tempted you, and that our labors might have been. But Timothy has just now come to us from you and has brought good news about your faith and love. He has told us that you have pleasant memories. You always have pleasant memories of us, and that you long to see us just as we also long to see you. Therefore, brothers and sisters, in all our distress, persecution, we were encouraged about you because of your faith. For now, we really live. Since you are standing firm in the Lord, how do we thank God enough for you in return for all the joy we have in the presence of our God? Night and day, we pray most earnestly that we may see you again and supply what is lacking in your faith. Now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus clear the way for us to come to you. May the Lord make your love increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else, just as ours does for you. May he strengthen your hearts so that you will be blameless and holy in the presence of our God and Father when our Lord Jesus comes with all his hearts. What a relief. I mean, you can feel Paul's relief all over this letter, which he wrote as soon as he heard Timothy's report, as we get to end verse 6. Paul's greatest fear for these new believers in Thessalonica was how persecution might have affected these infant Christians.
Christians and how satanic lies about Paul's motives might endanger their new life in Christ and sour their desire to ever see Paul or his team again. Instead, however, Timothy had just returned from visiting the Thessalonian believers with good news about their faith, good news about their love, and that they had pleasant memories of the apostles and longed to see them again. What a relief. It is out of gratitude and out of relief, frankly, that Paul pours out his heart for these little believers in this letter, wanting to do everything he possibly can in his absence to ensure they continue to grow and mature in the Lord. Faith, love, and hope are the three most valuable and vulnerable assets a believer has, and they must be continually protected and strengthened. So look for yourself how Paul describes this here in chapter 3, beginning with faith, verses 1 and 2. Faith, first of all, is something you do. We sent Timothy, the Apostle Paul says, to strengthen and encourage you in your faith. Now, little words can make a big difference. Look for yourself the text. The word translated in would normally, in the Greek, translated into English as the word for, F-O-R. But that comes off a bit awkward when you put it in English. It would say, we sent Timothy to strengthen and encourage you for your faith. And it's like, yeah, it makes sense, but we don't really talk like that. But you see, it's not their faith Paul is talking about what needs to be strengthened and encouraged. It's the believers themselves Paul wants to strengthen and encourage for their faith. Now, the translation gets the meaning across, obviously, but what's lost here is how personal the original language is. Think of it this way. When a diver needs the safety of the boat to dive among sharks, he can talk to other divers and those on the boat by radio. Those on the boat can typically see the divers and the sharks from above and giving them critical information about where the sharks might be coming from. Likewise, the divers look out for each other, covering each other's blind spots. So, when someone from the boat or another diver says over your radio, I've got you covered, they're giving you strength and encouragement for your dive. It is not your dive that is strengthened and encouraged. It's you. Faith, like diving among sharks, is something you do, and you need to be strengthened and encouraged while doing it. As it says in Isaiah chapter 7, the last half of verse 9, if you do not stand firm in your faith, you will not stand at all. Also, as you see in verses 3 and 4, faith is not just something you do. Faith is designed, it is designed for danger. Look for yourself. The reason Timothy was sent to check on the Thessalonian believers was that they were in a dangerous situation. They were being persecuted for their faith in Jesus as Messiah. But notice this. Timothy was not sent to protect the Thessalonians from the danger they were in. He was sent, quote, so that no one would be unsettled by these trials. For you know quite well, we are destined for them, verse 3. You see, it's not that we might encounter trials because of our faith. We are destined to encounter trials because of our faith in Jesus. The truth is, faith is designed by God to put us in the middle of trials, just as shark diving is designed to put you in the middle of the ocean's most fearsome apex predators. God wants you in the midst of trials. Thank you. Since this is true, our job as believers, nobody's really smiling. I see one, two, three, now you're okay. So this is not the message I wanted to hear. But since this is true, our job as believers is not to try to escape the trials we face. Think about that when you're praying for other believers who are in the midst of trials. What, how do you want to be praying for them? Because our job is not to escape from the trial we face, just as a shark diver's job is not to escape from the sharks. Our job is to bring those forces against us under submission to Jesus. Is there an amen there?
Amen.
Okay. These two. Jesus put his faith entirely in God. Listen to this. Jesus, and you say, yeah, I know he's the Son of God, he can do anything. Jesus became a man just like us. And he put his faith entirely in God to do what? To raise him from the dead on the third day. Now that's trusting. That's trusting the sharp dive you have volunteered for. And that's why true Christian faith is never, listen to this, it is never blind faith. Because it is faith in God, which has been proved completely, completely reliable by Jesus' life, his death, and his resurrection from the dead. It says it this way in Hebrews 2, verse 9 through 11. It says, but we see Jesus, who was made lower than the angels for a little while, meaning like us, now crowned with glory and honor because he suffered death, so that by the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone. He might take your death experience on himself. And bringing many sons and daughters to glory, it was fitting that God, for whom and through whom everything exists, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through what he suffered. Made perfect through what he suffered. The lesson in this is don't be unsettled. We are destined to suffer for our faith in Jesus, but we know that we will also be glorified like Jesus. Take a look at verse 5. Faith can be ruined. Paul says in verse 5, for this reason, when I could stand it no longer, I sent to find out about your faith. I was afraid that in some way the tempter had tempted you and that our labors might have been vain. You see, what drove Paul nuts was that he was so far away from these new believers during this very dangerous time. And if we came to the analogy of shark diving, the Apostle Paul is like someone who trained these divers, yet on their very first dive on this highly dangerous mission, he is far away on shore. All he can do is get reports. And his great fear is that the dive may have gone terribly wrong and the divers lost. Paraphrase verse 5 just for the analogy. Briefly with me, listen to this in terms of the shark dive language. I sent to find out about your dive. I was afraid that in some way the sharks had gotten you and that our labor might have been in. When Paul sent Timothy to find out about their faith, his concern was for them. I was afraid that in some way the tempter had tempted you. And Paul had seen this kind of tragedy before, and he would certainly see it again. He wrote this to Timothy, 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. The Spirit, Paul says, clearly says, the Spirit, capital S, clearly says, that in later times some will abandon the faith and follow deceiving spirits and things taught by demons. Faith can be ruined. But then look what he does in verses 6 through 10. He connects faith and love together. Now, as I mentioned in the beginning, faith, love, and hope are the three most valuable and vulnerable assets that a believer has. Faith, and for you Bible students, think about this because it's not quite what you heard probably in Bible college or whatever. Faith translates the Greek word pistis, that much you know, which in its most basic form means persuasion. And by extension, it also means trust. Because once we have been persuaded about something, we put our trust there. We believe it, and we act on that belief accordingly. Over a period of 3 Sabbath days as guest speakers in the synagogue, Paul, Silas, and Timothy had persuaded several Jews and Gentiles about the good news of the coming kingdom of God and Jesus the Messiah as Lord. Their message never wavered from the gospel proclaimed by the very first Christians, such as Philip. Book of Acts, as you see it in chapter 8, verse 12, and it says this, when they believed Philip as he proclaimed the good news, gospel, of the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. So when it says in verse 6, Timothy has just now come to us from you and has brought good news about your faith and love, we are to understand that no amount of persecution, no amount of misrepresentation of the apostles has shaken the conviction of these new believers that Jesus is the prophesied Messianic King and Lord of all.
Amen.
These Thessalonian Christians were believers in the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ. They have been persuaded. And now their lives reflected what they believe. That's what faith is. Paul's concern was that their newfound faith in Jesus might have been overturned by strong opposition, as we saw in the last chapter, like those experienced in paddling a canoe might easily be toppled by rough water. Instead, however, the thing that came back to him was that these new believers were still not only afloat in the boat of their faith, they were standing up in it. For now we really live, since you are standing firm in the Lord, he says in verse 8. And you know what the single most important factor was in their faith not being overturned? Love. Look for yourself. Verse 6. Timothy has just now come to us from you and brought us good news about your faith and love. He has told us that you always have pleasant memories of us and that you long to see us, just as we long to see you. You see, the power of God and the power of the good news of Jesus Christ and the kingdom of God is that God is love.
Amen.
God sent his Son, whom he loves, to die for us rebellious sinners because he loves us so much.
Amen.
God is establishing his kingdom of righteousness and his kingdom of peace because he loves the world too much to let it remain a cesspool of hate and war and greed and disease. What persuaded these Thessalonians, the love of God, poured out to them through Paul and his friends? Consequently, what kept them glued to their faith was the unbreakable bond of the love of God that had formed between them and those who had introduced them to Jesus. Don't miss this truth. Whenever you lead someone to genuine saving faith in Jesus, you also bind them to yourself and to the church in God's name.
Amen.
Faith and love are inseparable.
That's good.
They feed on each other, and they strengthen each other. And together they keep the believer walking in the center of God's will. The scripture says in 2 John, verse 6, and this is love, that we walk in obedience to his commands. As you have heard from the beginning, his command is that you walk in love. Not rocket science. Paul was solely encouraged by Timothy's report because the same love that had persuaded them of the gospel also kept them standing firm. Therefore, brothers and sisters, in all our distress and persecution, we were encouraged about you because of your faith. Faith and love are two of your most valuable and most vulnerable assets as a believer. If your love temperature If your love temperature for God, if your love temperature for one another has cooled over time, so has your faith. And by the same token, if you desire to elevate your faith temperature, the solution is black and white. Jesus said it this way in Luke 10:27, quoting the Old Testament, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself.
That's good.
The love of God placed in your heart at salvation, it goes way beyond an emotional response. Love, like faith, is something we do.
Amen.
Regardless of how you feel emotionally. Love, like faith, is God's gift to you, planted in your life once you believe in Jesus. His Holy Spirit resides in you, and your responsibility is only to let the Spirit of God love through you.
Amen.
Paul put it this way in Galatians 5:22-23. He says the fruit of the Spirit is what? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness,
goodness.
Faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. These come from the Holy Spirit bubbling up in your life. Choose to allow God's love to flow through.
Amen.
It will wash you clean, flushing out self-centeredness so that you become a bubbling fountain of God's self-sacrifice.
That's good.
Jesus said in the Gospel of John, chapter 4, verse 14, whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life. Like a communion cup, you are a vessel of the light of Christ. This is why faith and love are inseparable, because both faith and love form a link between your human spirit and the Spirit of Christ within you. He is your link to eternal life, and you are his link to other human beings in need of his eternal life and his love.
That's good.
So let people drink from that little cup. Let them drink from your cup. They will be persuaded by the faith and the love they witness, and will change their life. And if not, they reject Jesus, not you. Let's wrap this up, verses 9 through 13. This is where Paul connects faith, love, and hope. He does it in a beautiful and clear way in 1 Corinthians 13, but here he does it in a whole different angle. So not only did Timothy's good report about the Thessalonian believers fill Paul with relief and joy, as we saw in verse 9, it increased his desire, it says there, to see them again as soon as possible so they could do what? So that he could supply what was lacking in their faith, verse 10. Now this wasn't some kind of put down. He wasn't passing judgment that they had grown up in their faith. Look for yourself. Paul just wanted to add more depth to what they had already been persuaded about Christ and his kingdom. And frankly, that should be something that we all aspire to pass on to others what we have learned so far about Jesus wherever we're at. We don't need to be experts. We just need to be excited about our life in Christ and hungry to share it with others. Amen.
Amen.
I have a niece. Don't live too far away from here, whose young son has expressed an interest in tennis. My niece thought that everything was to get him some tennis lessons so that one day he could play tennis with his uncle Paul. When I told her that I enjoy teaching others who have never touched a racket the game of tennis, and that I would love to teach her son, she was both surprised and thrilled. Now here's the thing. On my best days, I played as 7 on the National Tennis Player Rating Scale. And considering my increasing age, and likely decreasing time left on this planet, you hear what I'm saying? I'm probably not going to advance any further than 5. Probably going to go down. For all of you who aren't getting up. So why would I even consider teaching someone else tennis when I have so much to learn myself? And the reason is because I love the game, and I love watching those just learning the sport discover the crazy things they can do with just a racket and a tiny, fuzzy little yellow. But here's my real delight in teaching tennis. Every time we go out of the court, I not only want to supply what is lacking in their games, Paul would say, with them, I fully expect, and I tell them, that one day they will be able to beat me. I not only expect it, I hope for it. Paul's desire to supply what was lacking in their faith led to this prayer that he penned in verses 11 through 13. Now, may God our Father Himself and our Lord Jesus, may He clear the way for us to come to you. May the Lord make your love increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else, just as ours does. And may He strengthen your hearts so that you will be blameless and holy in the presence of our God and Father when our Lord Jesus comes with all His holy ones. This is a prayer of hope. The kind of hope that He fully expected to be realized one day in reality. And this hope that he prayed would become reality was, first of all, that God the Father and the Lord Jesus would clear the way for Paul and his companions to make it back to Thessalonica, and that second, the Lord would increase to overflowing their love for each other and for everyone else, including non-believers, and third, the Lord would make them so spiritually healthy and strong that they would be found blameless and holy in God's presence and Jesus' return. Well, that pretty well sums up everything he talked about in this chapter. I hope, and I fully expect, that a way can be made for me to teach my niece's son to play tennis. And I also hope, and fully expect, the Lord to make a way for me to pass on to others what the Lord has so graciously taught me about the life. What about you? Is there someone the Lord has put in your path that you can come alongside to supply what is lacking in your life and lives? Not judgmentally, just sharing what God has shown you in passing. I hope, and I pray for, and I fully expect the Lord to do here at Friendship what He does. To make your love increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else, just as ours does. What about you? Long before 1 Thessalonians was written, Jesus prayed in John 17, 26. He said this out loud as he prayed in the garden. I have made you known to them, speaking to God his Father. I have made you known to them. And will continue to make you known in order that the love you have for me may be in them and that I myself may be in them. As you consider your participation in this local expression of the body of Christ, what do you personally hope for as a member of this church? What do you personally pray for as a member of this church? Church, what we fully expect to happen, whatever that might be, does it fall in line with Jesus' prayer that God's love in His Son Jesus would be seen in how we treat each other in love? a reflection of Christ living in us. And finally, I hope and I pray for and I fully expect the Lord to strengthen our hearts so that we will be blameless and holy in the presence of our God and Father when our Lord Jesus comes with all his holy ones. I could go on a half hour about that one. But I'm so grateful this morning that blamelessness is because I'm in Christ and he's blameless. He's holy. His holiness, his blamelessness are transferred to me. Take me out of him, not them. But in him, of all the things you personally hope for, of all the things you pray for, of all the things you fully expect to happen, where does this fit in? We aim for what is of value to us. Jesus' return in glory with his holy ones is the great goal Paul placed in front of these new believers at the very beginning of their walk in Christ, because he knew that if they fully hoped for it, if they fully expected it, if they anticipated that history-altering moment, that they would work for it all. That goal would motivate them to live in a way that would please the Lord. That goal would motivate them to share the gospel, the good news that Jesus came to save mankind from God's wrath, so they would be fit for eternal life in the kingdom of God. So let me challenge you as we wrap up to make Paul's prayer your prayer as well. I'm just going to ask you to bow and I'm going to read it as it's adapted here for us. And if this echoes what's in your heart, just pray silently along with me. Our Father in heaven, may you and our Lord Jesus clear the way for us to help others grow in their faith and need. May you make your love through us increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else. And may you strengthen our hearts so that we will be blameless and holy in your presence. And our Lord Jesus, with all his holiness, it is in Jesus' name. The worship team comes up and leads us into our closing song. Let the Holy Spirit continue to speak in your spirit. Let these truths resonate. Jesus, as we saw a moment ago, made reference to himself as being living water. In the same gospel, the Gospel of John, he also made reference to himself as being the bread of heaven. Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life. Survey said, from now on, give us this bread. And Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never grow hungry. And he who believes in me will never be thirsty. Heavenly Father, we ask your blessing on
these elements as we take them in the remembrance of our Lord Jesus, of his death on the cross in our place, tasting death for every human being, that we might taste the glory in God those who believe. In Jesus' name. Jesus said, "This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And Jesus said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it. As we have expressed, as we have experienced this morning, the wonders of your love, the depth of your love, and how far-reaching your love is. You give us such beautifully simple ways to celebrate your love. We thank you for these elements and how they so effectively remind us your great sacrifice, that we may have life everlasting with you. We give you thanks in Jesus' precious name. Amen. It is the first Sunday of the month, and it's our custom here locally in Friendship to take a special love offering, a benevolent offering. This goes to assist those in our fellowship, especially who might be experiencing difficulty. Rather than do another March offering, what we are going to do is leave the place up front. And if you would like to give towards that, it helps tremendously. We are able to help so many people, and we're blessed that we are able to keep a balance and a minimum fund for that purpose. So if you would like to give to that end today, we just encourage you to do so before you leave the sanctuary. Just mark it as a check. And if it's not a check, it's cash. You can use an envelope. If you want to mark it as such, just put it in that will be just fine. So we encourage you to do that. Let's stand together. We're going to close with your worship with a reprise of that song, "We'll Praise Your Name." Faithful, and he will do it. God's people said it.